AP 120, Chapter 11, Topics Pancreas and Stress. So the pancreas is an organ that is both part of the digestive system and the endocrine system. In the digestive system, it produces digestive enzymes and fluids via its exocrine glandular structures. And for the endocrine system, it secretes hormones from its endocrine gland related structures. And here we can find it. It is posterior to the stomach. So within the pancreas are little clumps of cells called pancreatic islets. The pancreatic islets have two types of cells within them. They have the alpha cells that produce the hormone glucagon, and the beta cells that secrete the hormone insulin, which you've probably heard of. So alpha cells secrete glucagon, beta cells secrete insulin. And they work to control glucose levels in the bloodstream. So if the levels of glucose in the bloodstream are low, so if we have low blood glucose levels, then the pancreas will release the hormone glucagon. Surprise, surprise, then glucagon increases blood levels of glucose. It does this by a few ways. One is to stimulate the breakdown of glycogen. As I'm sure you remember from Unit 1, glycogen is an extremely long macromolecule that is made up of glucose. So you have thousands and thousands of glucose molecules connected together to form a glycogen molecule. So if you break down glycogen, you release glucose. And that gets released into the bloodstream. Glucagon also stimulates the conversion of non-carbohydrates into glucose. So, for instance, triggering the liver to turn amino acids into glucose. And then that will raise glucose levels in the bloodstream. Insulin, surprise, surprise, is in charge of the opposite response. So if glucose levels are too high, glucose levels in the blood are too high, then the pancreas releases insulin to decrease those levels. And the insulin does this by a few mechanisms. One is it promotes the facilitated diffusion of glucose into cells. So there are many tissues of the body, cells of the body that can take glucose out of the bloodstream. So insulin triggers those tissues to do that. So tissues in the liver, in fatty tissue, in muscular tissue, removing glucose from the bloodstream. It also stimulates the liver to form glycogen. So glycogen is made of glucose, so the liver starts making these huge molecules of glycogen out of glucose molecules, basically allowing the liver to take up more glucose as it keeps making more glycogen. Insulin also increases protein synthesis, so more proteins are being produced, and it stimulates adipose tissues to store fat. So the adipose cells picking up that glucose are going to try and turn it into triglycerides, into fats, and all with the purpose of lowering glucose levels. So glucose levels are getting too high. Levels are too high. This is the stimulus. Blood glucose levels are too high. This causes the beta cells to detect this and secrete the hormone insulin. Insulin goes into the bloodstream and affects its targets. To promote movement of glucose into cells and stimulate formation of glycogen. And then that lowers the glucose blood levels, and that causes the pancreas to stop producing insulin. You also have the other effect. If glucose levels are too low, blood glucose levels are low, this triggers the alpha cells. They sense this and produce glucagon. Glucagon is the hormone, goes to into the bloodstream, into various tissues, and does things like stimulating liver cells to break down glycogen. Glycogen gets turned into thousands of molecules of glucose that can now be released to the bloodstream. And it also stimulates the liver to turn non-carbohydrates into glucose. So turn things like amino acids into glucose to be released into the bloodstream. And then blood levels return to normal, and the pancreas stops releasing glucagon. Diabetes mellitus, more commonly just called diabetes. And this is caused by an inability to use or to produce insulin. So the two main categories of diabetes mellitus, there's type 1 diabetes. In type 1 diabetes, the person's immune response destroys the beta cells. So their own immune response is destroying the pancreatic beta cells. The beta cells decrease in number, thereby decreasing the amount of insulin produced until eventually all the beta cells are gone and no insulin is being produced. It's of course treated by having the person take insulin regularly. Then there's type 2 diabetes. Type 2 diabetes is much more common, including more common in obese individuals. Basically what happens is the target cells to insulin become resistant to the hormones. So it takes more and more insulin to trigger the same number of cells to take glucose out of the bloodstream. And this eventually, the buildup of the need for more insulin to be produced becomes too much for the pancreas. The pancreas cannot produce enough insulin to trigger the response needed, and that causes the symptoms of diabetes, which include blurred vision, increased thirst, need to urinate, feeling tired or ill, reoccurring gum, skin, bladder infections, dry, itchy skin, unexpected weight loss, which is interesting since type 2 diabetes is common in obese individuals, slow healing of cuts and bruises, and potentially a loss of feeling or tingling in the feet. And type 2 diabetes can be treated by having the person take additional insulin, but if it's thought that it's weight, overweight, that's the issue triggering the diabetes, then often they will try to get the person to lose enough weight. And if they do, it is common, not always, but common for those people to then no longer have diabetes. All right. The pineal gland. Pineal gland, part of the brain, found on the posterior side here, the pineal gland. It is able to produce the hormone melatonin, which you may have heard of as a supplement sold at health stores. Melatonin is important because it helps us maintain our 24-hour circadian cycle. So it's important for our sleep-wake cycle. So what happens is when it's dark, when our eyes are not being affected by light, this triggers the release of melatonin. Melatonin then starts the cascade of signals that cause us to get sleepy and eventually go to bed. So melatonin is important for maintaining our sleep-wake cycle, being triggered by the absence of light. It's thought also the pineal gland is involved in the start of sexual maturation, so helps initiate puberty, but that is still being investigated. All right, we have the thymus. The thymus is found in the thoracic cavity. It's superior to the heart. The thymus is involved in the maturation of T cells, of T lymphocytes, which are important for our immune response. And the hormones that do this is thymopoietin and thymosins. So these hormones start with the letters T-H-Y-M-O, thymo, are produced by the thymus to help in the maturation of T cells. Reproductive structures. The ovaries produce estrogen and progesterone. The placenta, when present, produces estrogen, progesterone, and gonadotropin. And the testes produce testosterone. These hormones are important for the development of secondary characteristics during puberty, important for the proper production of the oocytes and sperm. And we will go into a lot more detail about this when we get to the reproductive system. A few other examples of structures with endocrine functions, the kidneys. Kidneys, as we know, have the active form of vitamin D stored. That is called calcitriol. So when needed, calcitriol is released to increase absorption of calcium by the intestines. Kidney also produces the hormone erythropoietin. Erythro is related to red blood cells. So erythropoietin stimulates red blood cell production in the red bone marrow. And the heart releases the hormone atriopeptin. Atriopeptin actually goes to the kidneys and increases sodium and water loss in urine. So urine becomes more dilute, and losing that excess water from the bloodstream lowers blood pressure. So decreased blood volume by getting more dilute urine will also decrease blood pressure. Stressors. Stressors produce stress, and they are good in the short term, but in the long term, they can lead to issues involving our homeostasis, or maintaining a stable internal environment. So stress is good when it's in short bursts, but not good if it becomes a chronic effect. So stressors, these things that produce stress, increases the activity of the sympathetic division of the nervous system. Sympathetic division of the nervous system, this is the system that controls the fight or flight response. And part of that, of course, is a key function of the hypothalamus. So we have our sensory division of the peripheral nervous system sending information to the central nervous system, and then the central nervous system sending out commands via the motor nervous system. And it has two systems, somatic nervous system and autonomic nervous system. The autonomic nervous system has the sympathetic division for fight or flight response and the parasympathetic division for the rest and digest responses. We'll be going over this in detail in the nervous system, chapter 9. So, stress stimulates the sympathetic division of the autonomic nervous system. Stress can be physical or psychological. It could be seeing a truck coming straight at you, or it could be the overwhelming dread from having to take an exam. Stress can be, when it's physical, can also be involving the threatening of tissues, causing tissues to potentially get damaged. So extreme cold, prolonged exercise, doing way too much exercising, infections, these are all things that could cause physical stress. Psychological stress, real or perceived, can lead to anger, depression, fear, anxiety, and grief. So a lot of things can cause psychological stress. Again, you experience the stress causing a change in the internal environment. It is detected. The hypothalamus will send out signals to the adrenal medulla to release epinephrine and norepinephrine. And this will lead to the short-term fight or flight response. And this, of course, has like various effects. Blood glucose increases, glycerol and fatty acids increase, heart rate increases, blood pressure increases, breathing rate increases, air passage dilates, pupil dilate. Anyway, there's a lot of things that occur in the fight or flight response. Short term, that's okay. That's saying, hey, we need to get in action and do something about this. But it also leads to the release of the cortical releasing hormones that cause the anterior pituitary gland to release the adrenal corticotropic hormones, which cause the adrenal cortex to release cortisol. Cortisol gets to be a problem if it's around too long. So chronic stress leads to chronic cortisol production. And this leads to amino acid levels in the bloodstream getting high, and the release of fatty acids increase. And the glucose formed from non-carbohydrate sources increase, which means now we're not doing enough protein production. We're not producing enough of our lipids, our triglycerides. And that can have a huge range of effects on the body. So extended long-term stress can lead to major problems because cortisol, that hormone, stays in the bloodstream too long. All right. And that is it for this chapter.